This video will be looking at current research being conducted at McMaster University on inhaled vaccines as a new technique to combat COVID-19. We also had the pleasure of speaking with Dr. Mangalakumari Jeyanathan, who is a senior research scientist at the Department of Pathology and Molecular Medicine at McMaster University, to learn more about these inhaled vaccines. As we have learned in the past year, SARS-CoV-2, which is a respiratory disease, works by first infecting our lungs using its spike proteins to attach to a protein called the ACE2 receptor to essentially unlock the cell membrane of our lung cells. Then, it injects its genetic material into our cells, where the genetic material starts to replicate, creating more viruses inside our cells, until it's packed and bursts open, causing the spread of the infection. This process goes on for a while before the immune cells start detecting the virus. Although once they do start detecting the virus, the lungs are so infected that the immune system goes into overkill and might even start damaging healthy cells. We'll now try to understand the types of immune responses that are recruited during this process. The immune system is made up of two parts: the innate immune system, which is general defense, and the adaptive immune system, which is more specialized. The innate immune system consists of the skin and mucous membranes, as well as innate immune cells. Innate immune cells consist of white blood cells such as macrophages, neutrophils, and natural killer cells. The adaptive immune system consists of white blood cells such as B cells and T cells, and takes over if the innate immune system fails to defend against the pathogens. Through this process, specific germs are identified, and the adaptive immune system is able to remember and recognize pathogens if they are encountered again in the future. So how does the vaccine work? Although the current injectable vaccine is given intramuscularly, it takes a while to actually provide the lungs with a fast, robust immune response. On the other hand, the new inhaled vaccine actually uses a jet nebulizer, which is a complicated word for a machine that turns the contents of the vaccine into extremely tiny droplets of mist, which, as you can see here, are inhaled directly through the mouth and into the lungs. This will directly reach the depths of the lungs and to the surface of the lung cells and recruit fast and strong short-term and long-term immune responses right in the lungs. How is the vaccine developed? The concept of the inhaled vaccine stems from clinical trials that have taken place for the development of vaccines for tuberculosis. The researchers at McMaster used an adenovirus, which is the virus responsible for the common cold, and genetically modified it to remove the genes that were responsible for its ability to replicate. This ensures that the vaccine doesn't cause the actual illness or infect recipients. McMaster University is testing two types of adenovirus inhaled vaccines. One is a human adenovirus vector, and the other is a chimpanzee adenovirus vector. The adenovirus is modified to carry the genetic material for three proteins of SARS-CoV-2. These three proteins, rather than the one spike protein which the current vaccines have, will allow for stronger protection against variants, since proteins like the nucleoprotein, which are inside the virus, remain somewhat similar across each variant, while the spike protein, which is present on the surface of the virus, is more likely to change. The vaccine essentially trains our lungs to recognize these three proteins the adenovirus warned our immune system about. So the next time the actual virus is inhaled into our lungs, our immune system recruits IgA and IgG antibodies that remember the virus and protects against future reinfections. Now for our interview with Dr. Mangalakumari Jeyanathan. What are the benefits of the inhaled vaccines?
For the SARS-CoV-2, this has the tendency to infect the lower respiratory tract. That's where the people get pneumonia and get really, really sick. Inhalation allows us to target the deeper part of the lung as well. So that's one of the good thing about inhaled vaccines. Giving inhaled vaccine may be able to give us protection against variants as well. Because, you know, as I told you, it's not only induce specific antibodies, it also induce T cells as well.
Do inhaled vaccines protect against variants?
Most of the vaccines, or even these mRNA vaccines, they are having the antigens that's expressed outside, that's a spike protein. So our vaccine has spike protein, as well as some of the internal proteins as well. So when it comes down to mutation, that's what caused the variants to arise. The mutations mostly happen on the surface proteins, not in these proteins inside. So since our vaccine has all these proteins that are inside the virus, that's not usually get mutated. After our vaccine, we hope that it can recognize or it will be protective against any type of variants, because there is rarely any mutations happens in the proteins that are inside the virus.
How will the inhaled vaccines affect the public health response?
Very good thing about inhaled vaccine is it's needle-free. So it encourages even needle phobia people to take vaccine. Believe it or not, in a survey, I found that 20% of unvaccinated people said that they would take the vaccine if it was not delivered with a shot, 20%. And also what we learned from our inhaled TB vaccine trial is that we need very low dose of inhaled vaccine than the injectable vaccine. So we found that we can decrease the dose by twofold when you deliver this vaccine by inhalation than the injectable. So by this way, if you can use a very low dose, then there is much more vaccine available for many people. So it increased number of people we can actually vaccinate. The inhaled vaccine will induce strong lung immunity, which would be sustainable and protective. And we hope this protection will last longer, so we won't need very frequent booster vaccines.
Will inhaled vaccines help with global health inequities?
When it's come down to this inequity, to avoid this inequity, we really have to think well ahead. So the vaccine should be cost effective. It shouldn't be expensive so that everyone can afford it, right? And the other important factor of any vaccine is that should be stable throughout its shelf life at ambient conditions, so that it can be used in warmer countries or in developing countries via the resource poor situations. We can use that, so we don't need a cold chain to maintain the vaccine, right? So in this case, I think inhaled vaccines have an advantage because they can be formulated to dry powder. So we can just, and the dry vaccines can be more stable and can be stored at ambient conditions. There is no need for a cold chain. So this is really good that we can just transport it anywhere without any specific requirements. And it can be transported to rural areas to be delivered. So that's one of the very important aspect of inhaled vaccine when it's come down to applications to humans, right? Once the powder is formed, then we can just put it into these inhalers. You may seen inhalers, right? So it can be just put into inhalers, and then these inhalers can be just used to deliver the vaccine. So that's the other nice thing about these inhaled vaccines. And also, once you make them into powder, they are less weight. So bulk transportation is even much easier because it's not as weight as the liquid vaccines. You need bottles and all that. It's heavy, right? So the bulk transportation would be much easier. So in terms of inequity, I think with inhaled vaccines and proper thinking process before producing these vaccines, I think we can overcome the problem with this inequity, global vaccine inequity.
Currently, the vaccine is in phase one of clinical trials, meaning the vaccine is being tested on human volunteers. The estimated completion of the vaccine trials are set for June 30th, 2023, after which, depending on the trial results, it may become available for the public. Thank you so much to Dr. Jeyanathan for taking the time to speak with us and inform us on the new inhaled vaccine. We hope to see them being used for the public soon.